Today we have a very special and distinguished guest with us, none other than His Excellency Dr. Rashid Al-Leem, who, as all of you know, is the chairman of Sharjah Electricity and Water Authority. He was not only chosen at a very young age to be a part of the project of building an economic zone in the Emirate by the ruler of Sharjah, His Highness Sheikh Sultan bin Mohammed Al-Qasimi, but was also honored with the title of Ambassador of Knowledge of the United Arab Emirates by the Prime Minister and Vice President of UAE and the ruler of Dubai, His Highness Sheikh Mohammed bin Rashid Al Maktoum. He has also received several recognitions all over the world for all of his work in every field. And having said all of this, one of the most important things that he has always been passionate about is writing. So let us get to know more about him. It is with immense pride and pleasure that I would like to welcome him on behalf of UBL TV. Thank you so much for doing this with us, sir.
Thank you very much for having me in your program.
Thank you.
Pleasure.
So, sir, can you tell us more about your website that you have launched? The website that is about, you know, your books.
Right. Well, first of all, I had a dream about 20 years back.
Okay.
My dream was to spread knowledge as a power. But I always say knowledge is power of applied and shared only.
Yes.
So if you only have the knowledge, but you are not sharing the knowledge, you're not applying the knowledge, then it is not power. Just you're fooling yourself. So I started giving presentations, then I started to attend local, regional, and global forums. And they started to talk about the importance of the knowledge and how the knowledge can be communicated through the knowledge management. And then I thought, well, that might not be the only way, because there are some book lovers, people who love to read.
Yes.
And one thing I also noticed that, okay, but writing what? People love stories. Generally speaking, because the stories, they are soul, they really get you engaged.
Yes.
And they take you to the different time zones, they take you to different places, they take you to the mindset of the writer. And the writer when he writes, he would write with his, especially if he's passionate about the writing, then he will write deep what goes inside his mind and what goes inside his heart, and that's the very important point.
Correct.
Here. So I started to write about what molds us together as a human. What does it mean to be human? What does it mean to be a great person? What does it mean to have a legacy while you're living a legacy after you leave this the whole ground? Then I thought sustainability is the key, is the buzzword. So I started to do a lot of research, a lot of R&D, visiting universities, talking to scholars, professors, common people, very government officials from president of countries whom I had interaction with and whom I know in a person, to the chief ministers, prime ministers, ministers, and to the very common person on the ground. And I found that there is really a gap of the sustainability because it's been misunderstood by a lot of people. People thought sustainability is only about the environment. But sustainability to me is bigger than the environment. Sustainability is about three main pillars, one, two, three. One is the environment, yes. Second, and to me is the most important, is the social, is the people. And third is the economy. So money is still needed in the system. So, but if you can visualize sustainability like three circles, if you put all the circles on top of each other, there will be a meeting point if you just throw them randomly. The meeting point among the three circles is the sustainability. So sustainability is the blending of or the meeting point of the economy, the society, and the environment.
Mm-hmm.
So it is, let's say, divided in 33.33% among the three. So if you look at the sustainability from this perspective, then you can declare that you're a civilization builder. Then this is where the civilization built throughout the history, any civilization built is built with those three terms. And I started to preach about sustainability, writing books about it. And then I thought, okay, I run through, I published three books about sustainability. One of the books which really to my heart is the foreword was written by the former president of Singapore. He was a friend of mine. He was kind enough. We really lost him last year. He lost a great friend. But he was kind to write me the foreword for the brand.
Okay.
That really touched my heart when he has written it, because he said we both meet in the human side of us, and help the humanitarian and help the people to grow. And then started to write my commitment to the 17 global goals of sustainable development. They were issued at the end of 2015, and I issued a small book called I Am Committed to the 17 Global Goals, just to show my commitment to the, and I put my personal stories for each goal. Just telling the people, whether you're an executive, you're a government servant, you're a businessman, still you can have a story to be shared and to be told. So please share with the world, share with us, what is your story and the sustainability? And for that, I'm happy to say that I was awarded as one of the goodwill ambassadors of the UN, which I really feel good about, because you know you're giving something to the humankind, you're leaving a legacy. Then back in 2014, when His Highness was selected me to run the SEWA as one of the biggest organization on the government, I ran through a tough transformational change, changing the culture, changing the mindset, changing the people attitude, changing the whole perspective of the organization, because really I wanted to take it from A to Z.
You mean to say before you joined, it was a different kind of...
No, it was totally different management. Huh. It wasn't up to His Highness' expectation. It wasn't up to the...
So the work culture was completely different.
Was different. So I came to do the big transformation. I call it the big bang transformation in every single corner of the organization. And it was a really very successful story throughout the changes, the change process. Then I came through again, a lot of stories again. So I thought, why don't to write it down? Because very seldom, and this is unfortunate in this part of the world, you know much about the business people or the business environment, or probably you read from the newspaper or sometimes the TV. But as a real autograph or biography of someone, or a real stories, very seldom to see some books are written.
Yes.
So that I decided to write, and the beauty of my writing that I don't have a ghost writer, as they say. It's not that somebody is writing for you, and no,
so
I write it from myself,
100%
myself. And since English is not my mother tongue, but I kept learning because I love reading since I was young. So I had that ability in me to write and visualize things, and you know, try to and then get it copyright, get it edited, you know, all these things, and run it through the ISBN numbers and all those processes. It's very professionally written, the books. If you read it, I'm sure you, hopefully you'll fall in love with my writing. So
this one that you're talking about is the SEWA Way?
The SEWA Way is one of them. And then we have the SEWA Marketing Plan, SEWA Turnaround. So I've written 6 books now so far about SEWA. My hope, honestly, is to write 10 books, 10. It's a series. And, you know, and to me, writing is just like a relationship.
Yeah.
Building a relationship, it needs love and commitment. And this is what I do with my books. I give them the love, I give the commitment to make sure that I produce to the world something worth writing and worth reading. The feedback I got so far is really great.
Mm-hmm.
and really kept me going, encouraged me, because I don't sell my books. I have my own endowment fund to support my presentation, my travel, my expense, and also my writing and the books. But the feedback has been really marvelous and really kept me excited. And I used English. Mm. I do write in Arabic, generally speaking. Okay. I'm very famous on that part. Mm. I've been writing for the last 17 years almost. Okay. As a passion, it's not like a professional writer who's earning out of the books. No.
But usually, whenever somebody is really, really passionate about something, that's when the true, the true love comes out, right?
Because, you see, passion is about emotions.
Yes.
As easy as that. Passion, it moves you, it moves the whole body. Moves everything in you, with your heart, your brain, your the whole chemistry within you.
Definitely.
Because the passion, it's something that is, I would say, it's even bigger than the love.
Yes.
Right, itself. So I feel good about them. And then I decided lately to really create a website to share. My books are in some leading websites as a free downloadable and very major website and major brands, if you would, almost exceeded 10 so far. And in some of those sites, it's distributed to more than 150 countries, and they're free download. So I really felt very good because those who could not afford to buy, they can go to those sites and they can download it free. And then you find the beauty when you receive a letter from somewhere from Africa or somewhere from Asian countries.
Actually, that's what I was about to ask you.
Mm-hmm.
Because people here might have definitely read your books.
Right.
The ones who have actually downloaded from probably abroad or any other countries might have actually got back to you and told you about how they felt after reading the book.
Pretty much, yes. And a lot of them, they say, you know what, this is a great book for us because we never seldom read anything about business transformation or leadership qualities or leadership philosophies from that part of the world. Mm. So this is something really good, even for some Americans and Britishers and from those where the reading and such philosophies is always there, since there's all talk about their business driven societies in a way. So they are so much about literature, books, and other about business. Every single morning you go to library, there's something in you.
Yes.
But not the case here, So I wanted to contribute from my side. And I thought having a platform where people could visit you. Mm-hmm. And so far, even though we just started, but we're talking about almost, by the report, we have about 90 countries, people from different 90 countries visiting our site.
Wow.
And visiting to stay there. Because when you visit a very short, small site, you either go to the book, you download it, or there's you give your pledge for reading.
Mm-hmm.
As you know, 23rd of April annually, the UNESCO and the whole world celebrate Reading Day, International Reading Day. They call it 23rd. And they say selected that day because famous writers like Shakespeare, Da Vinci, and others, they died on that day. So they're just like sort of appreciation and just keep remembering them. They decided to celebrate 23rd. So if you visit our website, you can actually go to the manifesto or a pledge, and you pledge for the reading. When you pledge, you have as a goodwill from us, you can print your name on a certificate that says that you have pledged for the reading, which has our our logo and a beautiful certificate. So again, children and other people from different parts of the world where, these things means a lot to them, that they really pledge for reading.
Yeah,
they love it and they go, they're motivated because they get a certificate saying that, I did a pledge for the reading.
Yes.
So they show to their mom, their dads, and they say, mom, I've got our certificate because I really wanted to commit myself for reading. And that will really improve and fight literacy.
Reading usually improves the knowledge and, they get inspired, right? There might have been many people who might have come and told you after reading your books, I have been inspired.
Very much, very much. As I said, and I have my personal philosophy here, which is, again, it's an old saying, says a reader today, a leader tomorrow. And when you tell the children, if you really want to lead in the future, but you have to read.
Yeah.
So reading is essential.
Yes.
It's not that you are, you know, you have graduated and with this graduation you can lead the world. No, you need to read.
Correct. I think so, while coming inside, walking inside, I read that over
okay,
there.
Right,
it's
exactly.
Written down,
yes,
right?
Yes, true, true. In one of the corners. Yes,
it is written. And I was like, I mean, this shows that this person is actually very passionate about writing and reading.
Thank you, sure.
So that is really good to know. So now during this difficult time of COVID,
right.
How was it to let your people know, right, in Seva, that you have some extra hours of work, you know? Was it difficult to, you know, for them to accept the fact?
I think the whole world has not accepted the fact that this pandemic has come to change the whole face of the whole life in every single corner, whether it's the environment, the political, society, business, leadership, management, everything, because not even a government ever thought that they can go for a total lockdown.
Yes.
Never. And never a company given in their projection that their business will be 100% stopped. Probably there will be a dip or a drop in the business, but they never, no one thought that my business will go in 100% stop, like air aviation. Nobody thought an airplane will stop for some time.
Yes.
We have seen airport, they stopped totally for days, for weeks. Never thought of that. So this is, was beyond anybody's expectation. So the whole world, up to now, we are still scrambling the worldwide. We don't know what to do. We are living in a very reactive mode, which is totally wrong to me. Reaction is always bad. It should be in a very responsive mode, because when you respond to something, you can get the answer.
Mm.
When you react, you do more damage. And
so
the
when
whole
you say
world,
don't react and be responsive, what do you exactly want?
I'll tell you then to visualize it. If you feel sick and you feel that you're suffering from a headache, I know you have a family doctor or a trusted doctor, right away he will come to your mind. That doctor will give me the best. So you go to him, you see the doctor, and he looks at you and he says, you know what, Sharon, you need to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So you go and you go to the pharmacist. The pharmacist gives you the medicine. You go home, you take the medicine a day or two, and still the headache is still there. But since you trust the doctor, you go back to him, you see, doctor, it didn't do any well to me, any good. I took the medicine precisely the way how you described, the physician, pharmacist described it, but it didn't work. And he looks at you again, you know, Sharon, I'll just change the course of medicine. Please use, stop using that, use this one. Because you're trusting him, you start using the new medicine.
Correct.
First 2 hours, the third hour, you feel, wow, you're great, you're back to normal. No headache, and you feel a superpower, superwoman. So you go back to him and say, doctor, what's happened? He gave me the first set of medicine, didn't work. The second, really, from the third hour, did work very well. I'm back to normal now. And he said, you know, Sharon, what? The first time I gave you the medicine, your body was reacting to the medicine. So there was a reaction between your body and the medicine. Reaction is not good. The second set of the medicine, your body was responding to the course of the medicine. So responding is always good. And that is the difference between reaction and responding to. The whole world now, unfortunately, the whole world, almost, I would say almost, I shouldn't say, they are still reacting. So they say, you know what, let us go a lockdown for 2 weeks and see what's happened. Let us give it another, stop the school for a month and see what's happened. Let us stop the business. Let us do the lockdown for 1 week and see what's happened. So just wait and see, wait and see. You know, and deep inside you, you know, this pandemic will not go by tomorrow morning, just like that. It will take, it just came to tell you that I'm sitting for some time. I'm not leaving you. But you people are humans, are very strong creature. You will overcome me someday. It's just like what you did with previous medicines. But anything comes for messages. you know, and I think this is carrying so many messages.
Yes.
But it's not easy for anyone to read the messages. It is only those who are responding to the environment and to this disease. Correct. They will be able to read and they will be able to overcome the message. So we were lost what to do. Mm. So they decided, you know what, if there are certain diseases, if you are one of them, classified like, you know, high sugar, blood sugar, yeah, cancer and other, then you have to work from home. If you're pregnant, you work from home. Ladies from home. They did this. To me, this is a joke, sorry to say. I do believe that, yes, we have to keep them away. They have to work, but home, his name is home. His name is not an office. It is a home. It is not an office. When you convert a home to an office, it's purely disaster. This is totally rubbish. Because a home, you go back with the loved one, sit with them, spend the right time with them, eat with them peacefully, nicely, away from work. As soon as you leave the work, the workstation, you only think of the other environment, your personal environment, your home environment, your leisure environment, your free time, and you just enjoy the life. But to carry the work to home and call it OFIX or HOMIX, whatever you, yeah. I'm totally disagree
against
with this.
That.
You can to a certain extent, because productivity will be not the same. Mm-hmm. And productivity will come down. And there's reports now from America, mm-hmm, that the productivity has dropped to 35%. And especially during the weekends, Friday and Monday for them, is the worst. They would, people not even respond to the email, even their work, whatever, from home.
Yeah.
No, working from home earlier, it was there, but not as a job, yeah, as a full time. If you have some time, you're feeling not feeling well and you're tired, because you know they're driven by performance, especially in European and American, then you can't take so much easy day off from the system.
Yes.
So you stay home, say, yes, I'm not feeling good, but I still can respond to my emails. I can do little job, what is related. So your boss will say, you know what, I'm authorizing you to do this for today only, mm-hmm, or today and tomorrow. But not as a habit, you stay for 6-7 months.
But
so we need, sorry?
Because of the situation, we have to do something of that sort, right?
No, it has to be. I'm not saying, but don't please call it working from home or something. Try to phrase it in a way, and also try to not to give people that much of time.
Huh.
To be disconnected. Now, I'll tell you one. If you hire now, let's say a cameraman, and he's a new hire, you cannot bring him today itself to take this, okay, the important meeting, for example, right? Because he needs to be trained. He cannot be trained from web banner, from home. So what happened, those who are here, and they've been doing this for the last 10, 15, 20 years probably, he will be with them, and so there will be exchange of the knowledge. Now, when everybody is separated here and there, how the knowledge will be? Isn't it? And how, sorry to say, but how we get married, generally speaking, how we get the second partner.
Mm-hmm.
If we're in the university, I saw her, she saw me, you know, there's a certain things of both of us, or I saw her somewhere in the supermarket or somewhere, and you know, because we love the each other personality, and we start building the relationship,
yes,
isn't it?
Yes.
So the same thing here, this is disconnected now. If people are locked down, sitting in a, will be virtual, and virtual doesn't work. Would you like to establish a relationship with a partner or your future partner, mm-hmm, through web banner?
Mm-hmm.
I don't think it will work. You need to have face to face. You need to have the human touch, the interaction, and other.
Correct.
So, but at the same time, being a utility worldwide, there was a lot of pressing need on us,
mm-hmm,
because people could not again accommodate, mm-hmm, the to be out of shortage. Electricity, water, or the gas.
Of course.
So what we do, we really have to stay longer.
Mm-hmm.
So I declared a full week where I used to work 12 to 15 hours a day during the pandemic. It was during the tough month of mid of May.
Mm-hmm.
I declared that I will be here in the office. Even the food family refused to send me home food from home. I said, no, I'll go for a quick bite from the, you know, fast food restaurant. I'll just pick up the phone, call them up, I'll bring the food to me here. Just to prove to the world, yes, during those tough times also, we are needed, and especially the leader, they have to lead by example. I cannot tell those who are running the machines that you are there, you need it to be 24/7 and run the pumps, the machines, and the substation, and they're both sitting home, working from home. It doesn't work. So you have to lead by example.
Always.
So I was there for a full week, minimum 12 to 15 hours, even to 16 sometimes will go one of the days, and for 5 good days stayed here in the office just to show that there, and believe it or not, there was a business for me. Mm-hmm. Those 12 to 15 hours, there was a lot of, you know, meetings happening, mm-hmm. interaction with other stations, mm-hmm. through the web banners and other, and you know, looking at the reports and other.
So did it sink in well with the employees? Were they like, did you have to convince them that it's okay, you have to come and, you know?
No. The long working hour wasn't for the employees.
Oh.
It was for myself only. Just to show the employees, I was not forcing anyone to come. The employees were just taking it very light with the way how the country was going.
Yes.
So those who have, you know, sickness on them and other, they work from home. Those who cannot, you know, who come attend for 2-3 hours a day. So there was a lot of interruption, a lot of interruption. We really ran through a very tough period. And we're still running through that, but it's much better.
Yeah, better off
alhamdulillah, compared to earlier, but it's still there. Mm-hmm. It's still there. I think it's still there, not only with us, it's worldwide. If you see, it's really going crazy. And people, they don't know still why, because they're in that reactive mode.
Correct.
Come back to the reactive mode.
So what will you say are the lessons that you've learned from this kind of a pandemic, COVID pandemic?
It's a very beautiful question. I would say you have to be patient. You have to be persistent, and you have to be positive. I call them the 3 P's. To get out of any situation, you need to be very positive, very persistent, keep going, and patient. You have to be patient, really.
So yeah. I think this will actually also have another idea which must have come up in your mind.
Yes.
To write a book probably about.
Well, I have actually. As I said, my hope is to write 10 books about
books,
Sewa.
Yeah. So will this topic come in that?
Yeah, the sixth one is just released, and there's little bit about the pandemic at its beginning.
Huh.
That
the
there's
initial
a new
stages.
Initial stages of this pandemic was March when we started to know more about it. But hopefully the remaining one, no, we have a lot of stories about it. Yes.
Mm,
yeah.
Okay,
hopefully,
fine.
Yes. Sure.
So now once this pandemic hopefully gets over as soon as possible, it'll be easier to come back into the normal life, right? I mean, all the employees will be happy, and that kind of a situation at that time, how are you going to handle that kind of a change that is going to happen?
Well, you know, business, when the business get interrupted, to come back to where it was, it is very difficult.
Yes.
And it is time-taking.
Yes.
So it will not go, so let's say today that we have the vaccination available in one country, and they declare that this is a very successful, that the following morning will be, the airline will be 100% operating. You know, it will take time, just like the banks, the businesses and other. And then don't forget that, you know, the pandemic, whenever we overcome it, it will be months, years, you never know, right? We never know so far. But what we know for sure now is it is months, not weeks, as we were expecting.
Definitely.
Weeks, and it is months now. Yeah. Is the month going to be a year, and the year is going to be a two? We never know, right? But millions of lessons were learned, I would say, from at the global level. And we have seen hundreds of millions of jobs were lost, right? We have seen people committing suicide because they lost their daily income. It was that much pathetic. The food security also is an issue later on. So the consequences, I think, of this pandemic and other is going to be very severe. That's why we really need the wise people to stand up and do something. You said if the pandemic is over, and yes, I guarantee you, we are strong creatures, human.
Yes. Yes.
But it is a time taken.
Yes.
Once we find the solution to this pandemic, it will take time to go back to the business.
No.
But are we going to go back to the way how we used to do? I don't think so. Because if it's months now and weeks, people will create habits, and they say to create a habit, you need only 3 weeks,
yeah.
21 days.
But to come out of it?
No, to create a habit, whether it's a good habit or a bad habit. So if people are started to work, let's say from work now, for the last 7 months, we have people for the last 6+ months, totally we haven't seen them because certain disease they carry.
Yeah.
I don't think that, you know, after let's say another 6 months or a year, they will be very happy to come back, to wake up at 5:30 in the morning, dress up nicely, put a perfume, wear a perfume, and then come to work, and 7:30 they are there up to 2:30, and then they can go. I don't think it will be that much easy. It's great. It will take, and also, on the other hand, has put some pressure on those of us, both of us, who are really working, and half of their colleagues are not here physically, but they are physically working. So internally, they feel also demotivated in a way. But the problem, no one is really addressing such issues. What is the impact on me if I have to do 3-4 jobs, people, with the same wages, with the same salary, with the same income, with the same, you know, status? I don't think, people, general speaker, would like it.
Correct.
I may appreciate that my colleague, she or he, because of the pandemic, away for a week or two. But I cannot appreciate that they are a week for a full year. And you're expecting me to do their job 100% almost. Because some job you just can't carry home. Let's be very practical.
You have to keep
you
going.
Cannot. I mean, if a doctor, for example, how a doctor can, you know, tell the patient, you know, look, let me see your face through the webinar, and you know what, you're suffering from fever. And I think your degree is 39 or so, and you have to. It's impossible. He has to come. He has to have face to face. He has to take his way, his pressure, his sugar, his level, everything. Yeah.
So you told me when you joined Seva, like
yes.
in 2014, there was a total difference that you brought about.
Yes.
From what was happening before and what you wanted, what
yes.
you foresaw. So what was that major change that you would like?
The culture. The culture. Because when you, the culture is the heart of the game. The culture of any organization.
Yes.
The culture is the way how you do business. The culture is how you deal with your customer. The culture how you deal with each other in any organization.
You mean among the employees?
Among the employees, yes. And also outside, because your culture is like a mirror.
Yes.
Reflected outside of the customers, right?
Yeah, and yes. What were the kind of new systems that were introduced?
You know, two things I always advise people to focus on, principles and values. All of us, we carry certain principles in life. Organizations also, they are built on principles. And we built on values. The value is what drives you to do something.
Yeah.
What drives you to do something.
Mm-hmm.
So what values you have. So we were having principles in Seva, and we have core values, we call them. Timeless principles.
Yes,
and there are 15 of them.
Actually, you've got an abbreviation for everything. Like there are three P's, and
right.
there's principles and values.
Right.
That
right.
is actually shows how clear the clarity you have in your mind about
it. It has to be. You know, it's part of the vision, because here we are. Our mind in general loves to complicate things.
Oh, definitely.
Our heart loves to ease things, and this is, I keep saying, the great leader lead. By heart, manage by mind, and that makes the big difference. If you want to be a successful, even at the personal level, my advice to everyone and to the viewers here, please use the two precious things you carry, your mind and your heart. Your mind acts like a manager in the system, and your heart acts like a leader on the system. So you have somebody in and someone's on the system. When you have the heart and the mind work together, they synergize. They give you 1+1=11. Does not equal 2 anymore.
Yeah.
So it give you an outperformer.
Automatic synergy is created.
100%.
Yes.
100%, it happens, because you need to use both of them. Mm-hmm. But if you just focus on using only one, it will get you nowhere. Mm-hmm. It may take you to a top, but later on you will feel lonely on the top. Mm-hmm. You're the only one on the top, and feeling lonely is a very bad feeling.
Yes, isn't definitely. It?
Yes.
Okay, so now most of the companies are going green. They're going eco-friendly.
Yes.
So how far do you want to take that concept ahead?
I take sustainability concept, as I said. I take not only the green initiative to, you know, to show why machines are eco-friendly, but I take as the society.
Okay.
You know, and so how to strike the balance between the commercial and the society.
Mm-hmm.
That's very important. What people needs.
Mm-hmm.
So what type of good citizens I'm giving to back to the society.
Mm-hmm.
Is I always say the real test of any organization is not the great men and women or strong healthy balance sheet, but it is the men and the women who can do a difference in the society.
Mm-hmm.
That is one. And then in the economy, you have to be really recognized brand, adding to the economy of the country. So I'm always driven by the sustainability and the sustainability principles. It's not only by, when I say only eco or greenery, and then I'm focusing only in the environment, mm-hmm. and probably may not pay much attention mm-hmm. to the people and the society. When I see people both, the employees and the society. When I see economy, again, economy is both. You make sure that you give the right wages to the employees, plus you're giving really contribution to the budget of the country.
Yeah, okay. So now the smart meter, is it going to be applied to the entire emirate?
Yes, it is, yes.
Entire.
It is, because this is, again, this is part of the smart cities. Mm. The whole world is running. We have to live the reality.
Mm.
Everything has become digital, everything, almost, I shouldn't say everything, but almost.
Yes.
And people are pushing toward easiness of their life. So you want to pay your parking slot from your mobile phone, you want to read your email, you want to see your TV, you want to buy your books, you want everything through this beautiful machine you're carrying with you, the gadgets, if you would, in a way. So we have to be also up to the challenge, and this is a real challenge. So what we used to have, mechanical meters, and as you know, this is the whole world now almost, they decided to get out from that, to, you know, to go for either digital meters or smart meters.
Mm-hmm.
Digital will give you the digital readings. The smart will be connected to somewhere far away from the meter itself, so you could really manage the consumer's account.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
So now, of course, overcoming the pandemic is an ambition or an aim for the whole world, everybody.
Right.
Apart from that, are there any goals that you have set that are to be achieved by, you know, your entire team? Anything else that you have in the list, you know?
To share the knowledge, to share what we are experiencing here,
mm-hmm.
how the pandemic has really affected the utility company here. And we have published papers, international journals. And this is another thing about CIWA. We're not about a utility bill you receive. It's about communicating with education. So we have lately two important papers published internationally, one in the UK, research center, which is one of the highly respected, where over 400 universities is part of that research center, and one lately in the U.S. research center, which is again as a paper I did co-author with one of the professors, and it's published there. So I really feel good because that has accessibility to the whole world, so people can whenever they are interested in something related to the energy, and they can go and hopefully they will find our paper there.
Yeah.
So this is what we wanted. We wanted to share with the world about what we do and you know, the experiences we've been running through.
Okay, yeah. Now here at work, do you have any direct contact with Indians?
Oh yes, by all means, yes. Yeah, majority of our work stuff are from the subcontinent, from India, okay. Pakistan, and Bangladesh.
Okay, and specifically Malayalis.
Yes, very much. The very south, much. Yes, yeah.
Do you very understand much. The language?
Not very much. Kurchi.
Kurchi, that is good enough. Anything yeah. apart from Kurchi?
Not that much. Better to keep it for my own secrets, yeah.
Okay, so what do you want to talk about their behavior or their attitude towards work?
You see, the first time I stepped to or I traveled to Kerala was 18 years back.
Oh, okay.
That was my first travel, and I was leading a delegation from the Hamriya Free Zone to promote the free zone and what we give. And really, I somehow fall in love with Kerala. And since then, if you notice my interviews and other, I always say Kerala is my second home.
Oh.
Always. Kerala is my second home, and it is, yes, it is really true. God's own country, as it is highly publicized in that way. Very good people. They live in harmony. They live in peace. They live in love. And I've never felt I'm really a foreigner when I go there. That's the reality. Up to now, I'm still enjoying it. Just for the last 4 years, I did not travel because of the, you know, the different assignment and other. But earlier, at least twice or three times, and four times I took my family there.
Oh, okay.
Yes.
When, so 18 when years back was the first time you
went? The
first
ever time.
Since how many times have you gone?
Almost every year. Every year 2 to 3 times minimum.
Okay.
Yeah. Minimum 2 to 3 years.
How do your family feel about going?
Great. I mean, even the first time they say, you know, we've never been to Kerala. How does it look like? I said, no, let's keep it secret and I'll take you there. And believe it, when they went there, we spent the full 8 days. I remember the first time I took them. And you know, I took them around in the Kochi and different areas.
So,
and
in particular, Kochi was where you went?
No, Kochi, it's my preferred hotel is that Taj Malabar. I always love to see on that, on the island. I love it that. And then the old Kochi and the new Kochi and the good bar. But from there, you know, we went to, you know, Munnar and up to that extent, you know. The beauty is the quietness, the peace you feel there, the backwater, the water, the greenery, the people, the food. So you really
are
feel
okay with the food.
100%. It's not only me, the family, the kids, and they really enjoy it.
Usually, I've heard that, you know, our food is considered to be very spicy.
No, not really. I don't think so. Honestly speaking, I mean, because the people are living here, the restaurants are here, and at least not to me.
Okay. Yeah, okay. Yeah, so, yeah, what is your most favorite Malayali dish, if I may ask?
This is a tricky question. Maybe I would not be able to pronounce it right.
That's
but if
okay.
I see it, I could say this is the...
If you could describe what it is to me, probably I can tell you what the name is.
No, I mean, what I like about the very authentic food, when they serve it on a banana leaf.
Yes.
They put you the rice and the gravy and, yeah. you know, then you have the dosa in the morning and you have all these things.
Everything, yeah.
It's nice.
Now, what is your message to all the Indians, predominantly the Malayalis? Is there anything that, any message that you want to
I think about? The message, join hands together, it is better together. Yes. And I always say, leave your mark on this world. Be ashamed to die or leave without leaving a legacy for the mankind behind you. We are here to create a difference. We are here to work together. It is better when we work together, better to take the misconception about the societies, misconception about each other. Let us answer one question. What does it mean to be a human?
Yes.
That is a question. How we can enjoy the life to the maximum. There are two paths here. A path that you choose, or a path is chosen by others for you. So my message to that, whether the Indians or any viewers, I know your channel is one of the highly respected too, channel is, as I said, there are two paths, whether you choose or it is chosen. Please choose the one, not the chosen one by somebody else.
Because that is easy.
Live your life. Yeah. Don't be like a candle burning herself to give light for other, and she forget about herself and she dies. Never do that. Even if you're a loving mother to your kids and your husband or children, everyone should have his space also. Choose your path. Be connected with this beautiful universe outside there. Make a difference. Ask yourself, what difference I can add to this beautiful Mother Earth? Write it down. Start your morning with saying thank you. Just say thank you, anyone. Thank you, Mom, for cooking good for me. Thank you for being my wife. Thank you for being my husband. Thank you for being my so and so. Ask your security guard, thank you for, you know, securing us and getting in and out. Ask the cameraman. Just try to start the day by a smile and say thank you. You will feel the whole universe is really just like echoes. Everybody will say thank you to you in a way or another. So let us change the way how the habits, I would say.
So gratefulness is what is very important. You have to be grateful.
To be thankful, you have to be intuitive in a way. You know, you have to be intuitive. You need to have what's called mindfulness. You have to have your own space. We need to disconnect from time to time. You know, we become so much busy creatures, more than what we thought, and we are just distracted by whether the mobile phone, which we thought it is going to be, the families, the roads, the congested roads, everything. If you notice, no one is in a peace now with themselves. We're always busy for what? You don't know, we're chasing something. That's something we're chasing called the happiness. And once you catch it in a way that you feel, no, this happiness is really missing something here. I need a partner, okay? Because it's not about the gold or the money I have now. It's not about being so much famous. So you keep chasing that happiness. So you need to stop. My advice, for a moment, take a deep breath and see where am I heading to. There is a star called the North Star. When we were kids, I remember grandfathers, they teach us, Rashid, look, you see that tribe called, we never have navigation system, anything. But that star, if you fail it, it will never fail you, because that gives you a direction. And this is what we need now. We need, I would say, a speedometer to speed things. Yes, we need to do things in a quick, but we need to do it with a direction. Because when you do it with a direction, there is a time you sit, relax, and get up again and keep moving. Now we have speedometer without the compass, which tells us the direction. And that is the big challenge, I think, the people have. So my advice, if I have to summarize it, please have a speedometer and have a compass together. And as I said earlier in this beautiful talk, have your heart and your mind together. So remember your compass, your speedometer, your heart, your mind, and you'll be the person whom you wanted always be.
Yeah. So it was, truly, very truly,
thank you very
from
much,
the heart, yeah. Very inspirational.
Thank you very much.
You.
Pleasure.
All the things that you said are very inspirational.
Thank you very much.
An
pleasure.
Absolute delight. Thank you so much. And I also thank you, VLTV, to give me this opportunity to having this chat with you.
Thank you very much. It's my pleasure.